Good afternoon, folks. I'm from the CI team from PayPal. I've been working there since 2011. All the while, I have been part of the Jenkins team since we started using Jenkins as our CI tool. Earlier, we had a proprietary tool, and we started using Jenkins for CI beginning 2011. So all the while, I have been really proud of working at PayPal. As against my previous companies, PayPal, even it's a huge company. It's quick to adopt new technologies like GitHub, Jenkins, or C3 OpenStack. And we have been given the opportunity to work, explore multiple technologies and use them. So I'm going to tell you a story about how we started with Jenkins CI and how our whole timeline passed, how we scaled Jenkins throughout PayPal organization, being it such a huge one. And we take CI at PayPal very seriously. And we scale it as we need. It's not just running for the sake of it and it's up to the developers, but we enforce it. We enforce CI throughout the organization. We try to improve the metrics, code coverage, or reduce the violations, enforce it. So we got started in about 2011, starting with Jenkins. So at that point, we had a single Jenkins instance for the whole PayPal organization, which was thousands of developers. That was kind of an overkill. And it was one of the largest Jenkins instances we had at that point, even now, I believe. So we had about 40,000 jobs running on the CI system, Jenkins, single instance of Jenkins. It was kind of catch-all. It used to do about 12,000 builds every day. And we used to run everything, Java builds, C++ builds, Scala, Python, Fortify. Even we used to do deploys using them. We had our own plugins, which were designed to do a deploy as one of the job. So that was a kind of a huge instance. We had to have about 40 GB of RAM, a machine with 40 GB of RAM running to actually have this instance. So that was So I'm not sure if you are able to see the timeline. So I'm not going to talk anything about prior to 2014. Prior to 2014, we were pretty much using Fusion. That was a huge Jenkins instance. And we had a lot of trouble with the memory leaks. And as you are aware, Jenkins is well known, very popular as a CI system. The popularity is mainly because the vast variety of plugins it comes with. And with vast variety of plugins, with open source plugins, they work good when there are small instances. But when we have a huge instance, which is serving the whole of PayPal, that's where the trouble comes in. We had memory issues, running into memory, 50 GB. Sometimes we used to restart CI every few days, once every couple of weeks. So that was not sustainable. And this was kind of as you can see from the picture, you can see that there's a train and it's kind of overloaded. Everyone wants to get in. Everyone is getting pushed into it. That was the kind of scenario we were having at PayPal. We had to build everything. All of the CI for different technologies has to use the same instance. That was kind of trouble. And as you are aware, I'm not sure. So PayPal and eBay were a single entity a few days back. eBay had a few different way of approaching the problem. What they have done is they have provided single VM for each of the teams and each of the developers if they want to. That was an overkill. It used to be a 4 CPU or a 8 CPU box, and each user getting one VM. And they would be doing like a builds or deploys maybe like a few minutes every day. That was eating into the resource. That was not the efficient utilization of resource. But that has a positive, which is like they had the freedom of deploying their own plugins. They can do whatever they want with the system. Whenever it goes down, it's just they are impacted. Not everyone is impacted. So it had its pros, but the downside is it's not the efficient usage of resources. So they had a day, so this picture tells all. So the whole train is empty, just a passenger, so that's not the cost-effective way of running the railways. So coming in 2014, June, we started like looking at how we approach this problem, how do we resolve it. That's when we started looking at Mesos. So Mesos, using Mesos, we can use dynamic allocation of resources. We started using Jenkins Mesos plugin, and it was in its early stages of development. We adopted it, we made changes to it according to our needs, and we started using it. We started using Jenkins Mesos plugin for running our builds. But how about the CI instances? So we decided that, okay, every user and every team will get their own CI because that provides the flexibility. As against the other system where if someone wants to install a plugin, that was a huge process where they have to put in a ticket and it would take a few weeks before we could go through it, test it, and then roll it out. Because as we have seen earlier, there were a lot of memory issues and it being open source, we wanted to, don't want to take any risk. So we started using Jenkins Mesos plugin and started using Mesos along with Marathon. Marathon as a scheduler, we started running Jenkins as a job on top of, at Marathon. So as I mentioned, there are about 2,500 teams or users at the whole eBay and PayPal. So we were having about 2,500 jobs. That was a better utilization of resources. This picture actually depicts what we were doing. It's a comfort, it's a flexible approach, but at the same time, it's a better utilization of resource. So everything was good. And the utilization of resource, we had a 10x savings in resources. Earlier, we were using about 24,000 CPUs, literally. And it was 180 terabyte of RAM, 180 terabyte of disk and 54 terabyte of RAM. With 10x of savings, we were like packing multiple Jenkins instances into a single server. There were about 14 Jenkins instances running on a VM as against a single CI running on a VM. When a build runs, it used to use cluster on demand using the Jenkins Mesos plugin. So that's the reason we were able to reduce the resource consumption. So earlier, whenever some CI has to go down, it was, let's say the VM went down. Then the user who is using that VM for the CI has to approach us to get it back. It was not as flexible. But with Mesos, what we have done is we have made the CI failover. Whenever CI goes down, Mesos and Aurora by itself, right, it will restart the CI. And the CI will be available in no time. So this picture depicts what kind of experience is like. So we had got a very good feedback. We were kind of very happy with how things were going on. Earlier, people were having very bad experience. There were a lot of bad gateways because the CI was going down. They have no idea why were they going down, and they have to approach us. And it was really terrible if the CI goes down on a, let's say, weekend. Weekend is really bad because they work on weekend, and usually people work, we work on weekend because there's a crunch situation and we have to address deadlines. With the flexible approach of using Mesos and Aurora, we got out of it, and they were just getting back the CI instances, even if something goes bad. Let's say the memory consumption goes huge and the process goes bad, or let's say the VM itself goes bad, the hypervisor goes bad. Any kind of failure, we were able to recover in no time. It was like a minimal 1 to 2 minutes of downtime. So things were going fine, great, till we reached 800 CI milestone. It was around 2014 November last year. We were reaching about 800 CI instances. and we were using Marathon. At that point, Marathon was not able to handle more than 800 instances of jobs. So at that point, the immediate solution we had was, okay, the usage of CIs was increasing. How do we handle it? Then we went ahead and said, okay, let's shard the resource. Then we had like multiple clusters of Marathon running. That's not a great solution to maintenance for maintenance. Then we started having a long-term solution, looking at a long-term perspective. We started looking at Aurora and other schedulers. So there were kind of huge outages. This graph actually shows the number of outages happening over a period of time. The problem started in October, November was the peak, then it's December, we started rolling out the changes, and by March, we started using Aurora entirely, and we haven't seen any problem. Right now, we run about 2,000 CIs, but there is no issue. We have done an LNP testing using Aurora with about 500 CIs for a period of time. We haven't seen any issues. So we are going ahead with it, using it. So as this journey went ahead, as part of like solving these problems, we had to look at how do we mitigate? How do we get feedback when something goes wrong? So as part of the process, we developed different tools to monitor and alert if something goes bad. As part of the same process, we contributed back to the open source. And we have taken a total data-driven approach, looking at the log files, getting the data, and we had a system which could go through the data and provide us with some insights. And we provided about 20 open source contributions. And Mani is from my team. He is one of the core contributors to the Jenkins Mesos plugin. And he has actually released for the last couple of releases. So he has been doing well and we have been huge contributor to the open source community. And as I mentioned, since we moved from Marathon to Aurora, we had no outages and things are going real perfect. And to just give you a peek into the architecture of how the whole system is designed, so we have provided a very highly available solution. We have Nginx, which acts as a web server. CI as a service is our core application, which orchestrates the whole CI creation process. And CI as a service, this application uses Aurora to spawn the CI instances. At the end of the day, CI instances are running process on, using Aurora on the Mesos cluster. And we use Mesos cluster for that. The cloud is used for both Jenkins master and Jenkins slave. And we are using OpenStack for this. We are using object storage for the backup. Even if some of the CI goes down, we are using local storage for the when the CI runs for efficiency and performance. But when a CI goes down, we get the backup from the object storage. We backup every few minutes, get it from the object storage, and restore the CI. And all of these elements are highly available and redundant. And we use Zabbix for our monitoring and alerting mechanism. The other aspect is we use Ansible. We earlier in our journey, we had a lot of challenges where not all of the machines were identical. They were not consistent. So that was causing a lot of problems. We had to have a lot of issues where users were complaining about their builds not working. So we started with exploring Puppet. That was using a pull mechanism. Then over a period of time, we realized it's better to, when we are actually pushing, when we want to do a release, it's better to have a push mechanism which is supported by Ansible. So we had go ahead and started using Ansible for all of our deployments to QA and even in production. And we do continuous delivery using Ansible. And we ourselves dog food and we use Jenkins, our own system, for our CI purpose. So what from here? So as I mentioned, when you look at this slide, so these are different applications we are running at our system. And we have other applications, like as I shown here, we have a CI Dash, which is another application which monitors and alerts provides alerting mechanism. And we have other tools like the managed stages, which actually provide a deployment mechanism for the entire PayPal. So we have Jenkins master and Jenkins slave, one cluster, and we have another cluster for other applications, and we have another cluster for managed stages, and this is within our organization. And the other organization has their own clusters. So that's the actual sharding of the whole infrastructure. We have to have resource reserved for these clusters. So that's not the perfect way to utilize the resource. So what we are looking at is, how do I have an efficient usage of resource? The question is, how do I use Mesos as a single cluster and have all of my applications running? That was one thing came into proposal, and that's one of the goals which we are looking at. And the other thing was, as I mentioned a couple of minutes back, we had outages. Some of the Aurora instances went bad, three of them, because they were running on a single hypervisor, they went bad. Still, we were able to recover and have our system up and running. But after the event, what did we do? We went ahead and created new VMs and deployed Aurora and had it up and running. So that's a manual process, total manual process. So we wanted something where it's auto-healing, and we don't have to worry. There should not be any manual intervention. And we should be able to flex up and flex down seamlessly. And the other goal is, I mean, when we have one Mesos cluster and we allow other users to come and run their application, there comes a place where we want to have security. We want to have isolation. So we decided on like containerizing our applications. So these were the major goals to go forward. And the other usage of using containers was, we can do a continuous delivery pipeline where the user, the developer like me, can go ahead and like make the changes, create a container and push it out to QA and production. It will be identical. There won't be any other things to worry about, other environment concerns. So as part of the process, we started exploring Aurora. Aurora was providing container facility, and we also looked at Marathon. We also looked at Kubernetes. Kubernetes was one of the, Kubernetes is basically an orchestrator which orchestrates different containers. And it provides replication, it provides high availability, it provides a service level abstraction. We can say that, okay, I want to have these instances of this application running and they will be up and running, and Kubernetes ensures that they are up and running without any manual intervention. And it works with containers. So this sounded like it's a very good fit. So we started exploring the how Kubernetes works and how it actually fits into our whole system. So this is what we are right now. And I'm going to go ahead with the demo. We have just started exploring Kubernetes and see how it can be useful. So we have the whole system running at our private cloud, but we are also exploring the options of public cloud and hybrid cloud. And so we have set it up on AWS. So this is Mesos cluster at AWS I have set up. So I have set up Kubernetes on this particular VM, and I am pointing to the cluster, Mesos cluster, which is running on here. And I have started up the SkyDNS pods, and that's the only container which is running as it is as we speak. So as part of the demo, what I'm going to do is, So as I have shown at the architecture, we use C as a service application. And so that's the entry point where the user requests for a CI, and we will be providing the CI. So I am going to go through the whole process of creating a CI as a service application and using that application to create a CI. So as you can see here, I have set up Kubernetes on this machine. There's the API server process, controller manager, and a scheduler running. And so there are no pods, no containers, or no applications running currently on this cluster. And this is one of the VM which is part of the cluster. And Docker is installed, and there are no Docker containers running on this machine either. And this is another machine part of the cluster. Kubernetes has spawned Docker containers for its SkyDNS, setting up SkyDNS. Apart from that, there are no other applications running here. So I'm going to go ahead and start up our application. Before that, let me show you what the definition of our application is. We are running two instances of our application on Kubernetes cluster. And this is the Docker image we are using, which we have Dockerized our application, and this is the Docker image. I'm going to request for creation of the application. So as you can see here, Kubernetes, there are two requests pending for each of the instances replicas. And as you can see on the Mesos framework itself, we have Twitter scheduler, which is Aurora, and Kubernetes as two frameworks using the Mesos cluster. And these are two slaves which are part of the Mesos cluster. And currently, Mesos cluster is offering resource to Twitter scheduler. As it is a offer mechanism, it takes a bit of time before Kubernetes gets offers, and subsequently Kubernetes will spawn off the applications. So while this is going on, let me explain. So Kubernetes also provides, as I mentioned, service level abstraction. But we are facing some challenges with using the service level. So I'm not going to demo that part. We still are in exploring stage, and hopefully we will be overcoming this challenge pretty soon. So as you can see here, the status of the application has changed from pending to running. One is pending and the other is running. And you can see in Mesos cluster, so one of the instance has started up. And it's using this machine. So earlier there was nothing running here. Now you see a container is spawned for our application. This is the container ID. And we are exposing port 8080 from our application. And 31000 is the port exported from the host. So let me see, let me try to access my application. So as this is AWS, this is the internal port, and I have to map it to my the public IP. So this is the endpoint. So as I mentioned earlier, at PayPal, developers will be using different stacks. They are free to use Scala, Java, Node, Python, as they wish. So we support all types of stacks. For the demo, I'm just using a generic CI, which helps the user with just a CI. They can do whatever they want with the CI. With other types of CIs, we will pre-configure some jobs which help them in help them with the CI and CD process automatically. So as you can see here, we have the application up and running. Let me go ahead and kill this application. This is just to demonstrate that Kubernetes will try to spawn. So there's nothing running here. Automatically, Kubernetes has spawned an application when it has seen that it went down. It started, it's a different container ID. It started using the same port. And the service is still up and running. So this is the kind of high availability failover we are looking for. Now let me use this endpoint to create a CA. So our application publishes the REST API for creation of the CI, decommission of the CI, different CI related functionality. So let me go ahead and try to create a CI. As you can see here, it's a 201 response, which means that the request is accepted. And I have a REST API to track what the status of the CI is. So as you can see here, the CI is, request is accepted. 130 status indicate that it's in the process of getting a resource. And this is the Aurora cluster, which is using this Mesos cluster. And as you can see here, demo CI 12 job is registered and it's active. Let me go to Mesos and see what the status of it is. So as you can see here, the CI process is started. And this is the Jenkins process which is spawned. And it's using the port 31001. So, and our CI is up and running. And I should be able to go ahead and probably create a job. And I can build it. For this demo, we are not using the Mesos cluster for builds, but we are, at our cluster, we use the same Mesos cluster for builds too. So this is what I want to present. So we will continue to explore Kubernetes and how well it fits into our whole architecture. And we will be able to provide a high available solution with a single cluster throughout PayPal organization at some point in future, near future. Thank you. Any questions? Sure.
Are you running any of these clusters like the Docker container or just running like
a... So at this point, as we have just started with the Docker and Kubernetes, we haven't started using Docker containers for Jenkins masters. It's a process at this point. but we are planning to do a Dockerize the Jenkins masters too. That will provide a better isolation. No one will be able to corrupt any files, and we will be able to like push and pull the Jenkins containers as we want. So not yet done, this is work in progress. So from what we have known is Kubernetes tries to orchestrate containers and provides high availability and replication. And Kubernetes by itself provides resource management. But the motivation is to have a single cluster throughout the organization, which will help us have a better utilization of resources. That's the reason we are trying to use Kubernetes with Mesos. And we are not really sure if how mature it is, how good it will be. It's still in the early stages. And if we feel good and it goes through the LNP and we are good with it, we'll go ahead with this solution. Yeah, actually, what we are seeing is if the number of Jenkins or jobs or framework on Marathon were beyond 500, it was crashing. And we tried to reach out to the Marathon folks, and they have been able to help us with certain extent, to some extent. But with the scale and the scale with which we are increasing, it was not sustainable. We either had to like change the architecture of how we use Marathon or look at other solution. And as we were looking at other solution, even with multiple Jenkins, multiple of those jobs running, we had never had issues. And even when we were like drastically increasing the load on Aurora, it was able to throttle and still be up and running. It was delaying the creation of the CIs, but it was never going down. So that made us like go ahead with Aurora. Once we were totally comfortable with Aurora and confident, we did not explore further on Marathon. I vaguely remember it was 0.5 or something. Mm-hmm. Yeah, probably we have to try out how it behaves. With this model, with Kubernetes model, or the current model? Okay. So as part of the starting a Jenkins process, it's a script. Script starts the Jenkins process. At the same time, as part of the script itself, we also have a callback. The callback registers the updates the Nginx configuration. As I've shown, the Nginx is part of it, and we reload the configuration, and Nginx makes the CI available. The way we provide the CI to the user is a vanity URL. It's something like ci.paypalcorp.com/cname, and Nginx resolves to the particular instance of Jenkins. Thank you.